First of all, good evening to each one of you. It's a wonderful evening today, and we are privileged to have among us one of the most prominent and renowned social activists and environmental activists throughout the country. And she has worked among tribals, Dalits, farmers, laborers, and so on. She is an alumnus of Tata Institute of Social Sciences in Mumbai, and she is known to be the founder of one of the greatest environmental movements of the country, and you can say even of the world, Narmada Bachao Andolan, which tried to oppose the Sardar Sarovar Dam and all its ill effects. Then Medaji also was one of the founders of the National Alliance of People's Movements. And she realized that it is not enough different movements working independently. She tried to bring along many people's movements throughout the country who are fighting for their rights. And this National Alliance of People's Movements was born, and she was one of the national coordinator and convener of the National Alliance of People's Movements. And under the banner of this NAPM, she participated and supported various struggles throughout India against inequity, against unsustainable development, displacement and injustice, and so on and so forth. She has also been very actively involved and she founded Ghar Bachao, Ghar Banao Andolan, which opposed demolition of slums and fought for the housing rights of the poor. And in recent times, she has been also very much actively involved in the farmers' movement, which is one of the largest movement in the world, you can say. And they are all still at the borders of Delhi for the last 7 months. And wherever there has been injustice, wherever there has been struggles for justice, for the rights of Dalits, tribals, slum dwellers, Medaji has been there. And so it is a great privilege to have her among us, because she challenges us with not only her life, her movement, her struggles. And today she is going to speak on the challenges faced in environmental activism in the context of various movements, environmental movements, and especially in Goa with this Save Mole movement, anti-coal movement, and so many movements are already active in Goa. And so it's a great honor to have Medaji with us to speak on the challenges faced in environmental activism. Over to you, Medaji.
Thank you, Denzel Bhai. Meeting you, rather seeing you online after a long time. And happy to meet all the Jesuits and supporter friends from Goa. One would always love to visit Goa, not as just a tourist, but also as an activist. But when that is not possible, at least this kind of dialogue is taking place, which is not my choice. It's by compulsion, because offline is not so easily possible in the present situation. But the topic that you have chosen is indeed very, very important. And I'm not very organized today because I was involved in something very different. I've just arrived from the places where we were fighting yesterday in Madhya Pradesh. Yet the highlights which I had given just forms a framework. Please don't follow those, you know, very meticulously. And let me just have this dialogue and then a few questions at the end of it, right, Denzil bhai?
Yes.
So that would help me fill the gaps. So it's just take it as an informal dialogue, not a formal lecture as such. Friends, today in the COVID pandemic-like situation, or also in the era where we, India itself, and also the world, has faced not just viruses, but I saw many, many cyclones. And like the Yaas today, or the Amphal, or Okhi in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, and so on. And yet, we have been saying that, yes, we need environmental protection, conservation, promotion, regeneration. But I doubt whether understanding of the value of the environment as a whole, the treasure that it is, the dharohar, the heritage that we carry forward from generation to generation in the form of natural resources, and the support to life and livelihood that it gives us as human communities and society, is really fully understood. I doubt it, because we know that even today, the real challenge is having a sensible and sensitive understanding of what is nature and natural resources. If we are really for saving our health, our life from the corona-like virus and the various variants, we have to depend on oxygen. But we know that while this is being discussed and debated day in and day out, our rulers, our planners, are even during lockdown and immediately following lockdown, are all out to destroy natural resources much more than what they were doing before. And this I am saying with all responsibility, because one of the central ministers had said in her in his speech that we will have to speed up the development projects and plans 3 times of what it was before. Not just the speed, but also the encroachment and impingement upon the natural resource matrix is something that is happening. In Madhya Pradesh, for example, the fight to save 382 hectares of dense natural forest Bakswaha in the district of Chhatarpur is going on. And so is the battle in every river valley to save the rivers as well as groundwater, air, as well as sources of livelihood like agriculture around from the illegal sand mining. And that's what we all are in. And hence it is necessary that we really carry forward our understanding by not just ecological, that is scientific understanding, but also feeling for the relationship between the nature and people. And this human nature relationship needs to be really planning utilization of the natural, which we cannot say no to altogether, but the sustainability and equitability, justice, and also justification of using the resources for fulfilling any need of ours, and not just greed, as Mahatma Gandhi had warned us decades ago. We have to really take all these parameters into consideration. And that will happen only if we understand and we assert the understanding and our conceptualization of the relationship between human beings and nature. But what is happening, we know that right up to climate change, every issue related to land, water, forest, the Himalayas, Satpuras, Vindhyas, Western Ghats, the species, rivers, groundwater, mineral resource matrix, everything is being played with, played havoc with. And that depletion has reached such an extent that the 1,500 scientists have warned us already that the clock is ticking, and we may not, as humankind, survive beyond a generation or two. It is therefore necessary that we link the micro issues related to the environmental conservation promotion, micro level struggles with the macro level happenings, and also the not battles but a war that is going on. Now the summits and resolutions, the United Nations covenants to the constitutional articles in the Indian Constitution, everything is there on paper and ratified in one way or other, but that is not followed. Now this really needs to be our basis for not just understanding the threats, but understanding the violations of laws, rules, constitution, and covenants, conventions, all that is considered as the legal basis, but also to really assert our right to get compliance on. And hence, these two things are interrelated, the threats and the solutions. And as far as solutions are concerned, we really begin with assertion of people's right to natural resources. So we may quote this law and that rule and that article of the Constitution, like the 48A, which talks about the protection, but also the promotion of the natural resources and so on. But it is necessary that instead of just talking about the legal basis, we must talk about the human rights and human justice. These human rights are above legal and constitutional rights is something that we must understand with confidence. And such people's rights to natural resources form the basis for us to struggle to protect the environment. It is therefore the first principle is the principle of eminent domain of people, the society, the citizenry at large. You know already that since the British regime, the principle of eminent domain of the state was really taken as a basis for the rule of law. And that rule of law was really unjust rule. Like, for example, the land and everything attached to land was being acquisitioned forcibly with that 1894 Act of Land Acquisition. And it took 6 plus 13, 19 years, the two decades, to get that law changed to 2013 law, which is also not perfect, but at least takes into consideration people's rights in the decision making, in owning the resources and not permitting the extravaganza of acquisition of resources in the name of development, not permitting acquisition with no use for years, and not even permitting displacement without full and fair compensation, including rehabilitation. But even that is not fully and fairly implemented. So we know that although that 2013 Act is there, that and more so the Article 243 of our Constitution that came in quite late in 1992, which really defines the Gram Sabha not very perfectly as I see it, because it is conceived as the the community of voters. But we are not just voters, as Upendra Bakshi ji used to say it in the Narmada case when he used to plead in the Supreme Court, that my lord, they are voter citizens. So both the status of voters and status of citizens need to be understood, realized, and asserted. And when the citizenry is in the form of communities, can assert this right to all natural resources, we can take resort to the various laws and rules, no doubt. But there is something beyond that that needs to be conveyed to the communities, and the communities need to really feel it at the bottom of their heart, that when I live with these resources, I cultivate my land, I am using the forest resources, my produce, and so on. I am living since generations on the bank of the river or the coastal region. I have the first right, if not the ultimate right, and the as the only owners. But the first right gives us the primacy, and that position of primacy really can give us the right to decide how should the resources be used, with what purpose, towards what end, with what speed and magnitude, and what not to be done with the resources in order to save those for the intergenerational transfer. Now, this is something that really needs to be considered as a part of the principle of eminent domain of communities. And hence the territory is also an important unit. Now, one may define it not just on the basis of administrative units and boundaries, but that needs to be defined on the basis of socio-economic relationship and the boundaries that we can identify and use for defining our own unit for asserting the people's right to resources. For example, the riverine population or the coastal communities of the fish workers. We have to really make those communities empowered and powerful to say that it is our territory and we are not kings and rulers, but we are the lovers, we are the related existing communities, and hence we have the riparian rights and we have the land rights and we have the forest rights. Now, these rights, when are asserted, certainly the communities can be also conceived on the basis of either their occupation, as I said, farmers, fish workers, cattle grazers, and so on. But we can obviously have the territorial units in our mind. Without going into these details more, I will only say that this is not only in the case of rural or Adivasi areas. This is true about the urban localities also. Denzil Bhai was just referring to our Ghar Bachao, Ghar Banao Andolan. When 75,000 houses from 44 slum communities in Mumbai were demolished in 2004 and 5, within 4 months, we had to fight with the then Congress government as well, because they had promised one thing in the electoral manifesto and they were not really implementing their own promises. And hence we had to stand before Margaret Alva, and we had to enter the Sonia Gandhi's house at early morning, 7 o'clock, with 150 women reaching that the doorstep, so on and so forth. But we also had to assert the community's right to the land, which is government land, but they were using it for housing, and that right to shelter, which is right to life under Article 21 of the Constitution, could not be denied. So we gathered together, started a movement, and built the community on there and that land, except one or two communities. Even today, the people are living on the same land and the communities are expanding and growing because migration has become inevitable in today's economy and polity. And hence, they asserted this right. But then we also had to do that on the basis of the inequity-based analysis of the resource matrix, resource distribution, and the injustice involved in that. For example, again, taking the example of Mumbai, as any other megalopolis, while 50 to 60% of population is living in the slums, they are living only on 9.24% of land. And that land also is now diverted to big builders in the form of, through the schemes like slum rehabilitation. It's a very good and golden name. But in fact, what is happening is the horizontal community is transferred into the vertical community, and the land that gets vacated is transferred, and even the right to develop, the development rights are also transferred to get the builders better and the best land on the seashore to build not just the commercial houses, but also the 5-star and 7-star hotels. So it is necessary to not just assert rights and say that I am the owner, but also bring forward this analysis of resource distribution. And there comes the right-based challenge to the vested interests, whether that is those are the our own elected representatives, the politicians, the builders who are in partnership with them, whether they are the investors, local to national to global, we have to challenge them. And hence, when we talk about every single natural resource, we realize what are these challenges posed before us by the vested interests. Corporatization is something that is not just the concept, but the fact by the farmers' movement. And the farmers' movement's special contribution is challenging corporatization, because the corporatization in the field of education, health, has already led to suffering of the majority of our population and millions and billions across the world. But beyond that, entry of corporates into the agriculture sector, what will that bring to us? It will, through their various tactics and through their vested interests, take away not just the agricultural produce at the lowest price to be sold at the highest price, as the Ambanis and Adanis are doing and earning crores per day, 384 crores by the Gautam Adani and 1,085 crores earned by Mukesh Ambani per day. But that is also coming during lockdown, and that is coming mainly through their outlets for the agro-produce market, agro-produce-based markets. They have 11,000 outlets as far as the Mukesh Ambani is concerned, and are selling even the makai ka bhutta for 80 rupees in the malls owned by them. So that marketization is based on commodification of the natural resources and the natural resource-based products. Now that is linked to the livelihoods of the natural resource-based communities like the farmers' community. And hence, when we assert the right-based approach, we also have to expose the inequity that is encroaching upon our lives and killing us. Even when we have enough of resources, we have skills, we have labor contribution to the maximum by women and men, and those who are
ma'am, your mic is on mute. Father Denzel, can you contact her? And...
Medhaji, just unmute yourself. Unmute.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. For some time,
yeah.
It was, okay.
Just for two minutes.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it is necessary to really have this right-based approach. And when the struggles took up this approach, we have seen how the battles are won. Although the situation is not very hopeful, and yet we have to be optimistic. We have to really bring forth the struggles which we have won one way or other, partially or fully, without any arrogance, without any overconfidence, with all humility at our command. We must list down those struggles to give us further hope and power in our hearts and our strategies. And that's why I will refer to the Forest Rights Movement. That movement also finally brought in the Forest Rights Act beyond the 1927 or even before that, whatever the British Days Acts were. We got the Forest Rights Act of 2006 with a new cutoff date. Now, this cutoff date is not very good and appreciable concept, but basically, it gave the community rights to forest. Unfortunately, that right is not properly and with primacy and priority granted to the communities. The organizations as well as the state agencies are more for the individual rights to forest land under cultivation or under use. We feel that the first and the foremost a right that we should assert is the community right to forest. And forest means the land underneath, the minerals underneath, minor or major, the water flowing through forest, the rivulets to the big rivers, and the forest produce, minor to major, of course. So if that community right to forest, which is granted to this Act of 2006, is taken into consideration, that has been a result of the movement of the forest dwellers. Now, this movement also needed a basis of the alliance of various movements. And that was also from the local to the national level. And finally, one must acknowledge that Manmohan Singh, although he was also based on the World Bank, IMF, all the international financial institutions, he always was at the World Bank when we were fighting outside. But he at least granted this, saying that, yes, it is historical injustice done to the Adivasis, and they are the indigenous people, and hence their rights should be granted. Now, many environmentalists questioned this. They said that, oh, this would destroy forest. And I agree personally that this act at times in situations has acted like a double-edged sword, because the individualization and of the forest land under cultivation has taken place, and there are conflicts which have arisen out of this kind of individual rights granted to the Adivasis, who were mostly on the community basis. But I think the right kind of inputs resolve those conflicts, as we did in the Satpuras in the Nandurbar district of Maharashtra. And the proper inputs and interventions by the sensitive state actors also contribute to this. And it is also necessary for this kind of gaining rights and using those rights, operationalizing those rights, that we don't just understand the law, but we have the just kind of ways and means for the people who are the real beneficiaries of that law and the rules. And I won't go into details, but this is also a big challenge. How really we, while we assert the rights, we also assert the duties and responsibilities of the communities. We cannot say that it is the Adivasis who are killing the forest, felling the forest. We know that the story of the Birbal and Akbar, Badshah, which I always quote, that when the Badshah and Queen were sitting and he called Birbal and he asked him, see, who has eaten the mangoes mostly? And there was a peel of mangoes before the Queen. So the Badshah thought that Birbal will say that Queen has written, has eaten more mangoes than Badshah yourself. But no, Birbal said that, I see that the Badshah ji, you have eaten the peel as well, while the Queen has at least left behind the peel. So this is the real story. Today, when the communities, the elite kind of environmentalists point at the Adivasis as the fellers and killers of forests, they must rethink about it. And not that the Adivasis do not touch forests or at times lead to some destruction, but they are the ones who are the real saviors and conservators. Otherwise, the forest would not have been alive where the Adivasi communities exist. And the urban elite who really eat up and usurp the forest, including the minor forest produce like wood, they really feel that they can save environment by forming cup clubs in the international schools or adding a few lessons into the curriculum. No, the real communities who live with natural resources, not just on natural resources, are the real strength to take forward to not only assert rights, but also fulfill the duties. And they are contributing to that the most, which needs to be understood. All this really gives us the confidence to really carry forward. We have won the battles like the battle against the Enron. This was an international corporate with the Exim Bank kind of international financiers coming in. And there were the women who were fighting from the Konkan area, the Western Ghats. There were belonging to the fish workers and the rain-fed farming communities, so on and so forth. And when we took up that issue, how we had to go ahead from one front to another, I will just mention a few fronts that we could cross over to and make an impact by reaching out there. Now, this is an example of a big fight with the big corporate and how they had to bow down. We had to start with the community organization. Now, this is a real challenge before the struggles, because we know that the society and the community also, including the communities we are referring to, are today divided, not only on the caste and communal right lines, but also due to the market entry, the individualization, the you know, the what do you call it? The lalach, you know, the greed that is entering into the lifestyles and the approach to life and the resources around, and so on. But still, there is existence of the community life and community level relationships and interactions in India till date. Now, we have to really catch up from that. We have to really start with the community organization, and one can go on talking about the various ways in which we can organize, but I will just refer to a few. We must start with the women. That is because they are the ones who have the real perseverance as their quality. And when you reach out to women at the chula, at the cooking stove, you really reach out to the heart of the people's power. And hence, when you have the women with you, that is possible mostly through the women activists. I'm not saying that the men activists cannot mobilize women, but they can better mobilize and easily mobilize with the women activists reaching out. And when we do that, we have to touch their hearts, because they their heart lies with the natural resources around. They may not understand what is climate change and so on. We have to really operationalize every concept and relate it with the local experience. So we may start with an issue like Enron, but that issue slowly has to be expanded into a wider perspective, which can challenge the paradigm itself. For example, when we challenged Enron, we said that they are coming with money and market and the global force and power, but they have no knowledge and no right to our natural resources. And if we lose our fish and fisheries, that we will lose our livelihood forever. Now, this, along with the understanding of the global partners, is something that proceeds and progresses through our educational programs and processes, carefully chalked out during the community organization itself. And we had to do it. But we had to also go beyond the communities and reach out right to Exim Bank officials in the United States of America. And I remember when I reached out, reached that office after coming out of the jail and police custody here, also we can do that and we could do that. And there was an Indian legal advisor sitting next to the officials. And I then raised a question about his knowledge of the Indian law. And then when I could explain and establish that there was no compliance with the environmental law in India, and they were really ruling out the people's rights, the Exim Bank officials could not, and the Indian legal advisor could not counter us. So this kind of reaching out to various fronts, right up to global, is a must, because today, in many of the challenges posed by the corporates, those include the challenge by the global powers. And there we need alliance after alliance to be built in. When here we build the alliance between the farmers and fish workers, we could take the intellectuals with us who understood the destruction of the creek and the seashore in the Konkan area. We also took with us the trade unionists who had their interest related to the struggle, because Enron was for privatizing the power sector, which we are facing today, and the Bijli Bill, the new Electricity Amendment Act beyond 2003 of 2020 is really pending and opposed by the farmers' movement of ours. So that was the time when we questioned the escrow account and the whole economics and the financial fraud in the Enron private purchase agreement, power purchase agreement, and so on. So this study of all the legal, constitutional, economic, political aspects is also a must for every struggler. It is not just being a street fighter and then say that, okay, we will fight it out. No, we have to really expose and dissect all the frauds and the fraudulent ways of looting the resources and impacts social, environmental to economic. So I think that was one example. Now it is another story that while the Enron project got stopped here and during the struggle itself, but the police force really taught us many lessons. And we could know that the police officials from the government police stations and administration were taken on job by Enron, and they were acting as their security, while we did not realize it at the beginning till we faced the police atrocities. So it is necessary really to go ahead with the various fronts, struggle at various fronts. And there our force is the people's power. And our strategic path needs to be really worked out properly. And example is not just Enron, but also of our fight with the illegal sand mining. Now, how to tell you what we are going through even at present when we are fighting the illegal sand mining in Narmada and in many rivers? It is understood very, very lately that minor minerals extraction and depletion is something that leads to killing a river from where it is extracted. Now, this was not understood even when there was Air Act, Water Act, which prevents, which is supposed to prevent the impact on the water, like the pollution that comes in through sand mining, so on and so forth. But it was finally through the expert opinion and report in 2010 that the major impacts of minor mineral extraction was brought out, thanks to Jairam Ramesh, the sensitive environment minister of those days. And then that was presented before the Supreme Court. And the 27th February 2012, Supreme Court gave an order. And that order is the wonderful court order that can become the basis for any fight against sand mining. But very few people know about that order. Very few people take that order in their hand and really assert that there cannot be any mining without permission. And this permission needs to be based on the proper rules and regulations. But all of that was violated. And hence, the Durga Shakti, the IAS officer of UP, had to fight the battle. And finally, the Bar Association stood up in the NGT, the National Green Tribunal. Friends, the many orders of 2013 given by the National Green Tribunal addressing the chief secretaries of all the states are still not followed. And the new policy came up in 2016, and the rules of every state are much weaker, but still whatever space is granted there, we have to use that. And here we face not just the state authorities, but also the mafias, the violent mafias. Now, these are all the actors which are in nexus when we fight the battle for protection of environment. And you know all that, I need not detail it further. But I must say that when we are really using the laws and the legal regime, which is getting weakened today, we have also to take up the cause, as the youth in India did, to question the EIA notification of 2020. Because after the Air Act, Water Act, and the 1986 Environment Protection Act, and the 1994-2006 notifications, which really granted the right for public hearing before many of the seriously impactful projects are sanctioned. But even that is not properly taking place. And hence, people in Uttarakhand, through the activists like Vimal Bhai, Matu Jana Sangathan, had to fight every project in Uttarakhand through the public hearing, where the real public hearing was not taking place. And there was a tamasha of hearing, and the decision was made the way state and the vested interests, like the corporates to the mafias, wanted it to happen. So even those spaces are now going to be shrunk. And hence we have to continue the battles, not only at the field level, but also at the policy and law level. And this is also very, very interesting and interesting challenge. I'm saying interesting because the lawmaking process itself is becoming totally undemocratic. You know how anti-farmer laws are imposed during the lockdown? How the question hour in the parliament is really missing, how they are minimizing the time for the parliament sessions, and the agenda is distorted, and so on. So is about the assembly sessions, and the Lakshadweep kind of island is facing hell by killing all the democratic processes and the criteria for people's representatives to contest the elections. So it is that kind of lawmaking process, which itself is becoming undemocratic, needs to be challenged. Now, we are not in the parliament, but some parliamentarians, we may really take support from. So we reach out to the legislatures as well. Now that number of legislatures who can fight such battles for environment is also minimal, and that is reducing. But I think it is our skill and our technique. Just today, I drew a list of questions to be asked in one of the assemblies. But how we go ahead with using the legislatures, a small group forming a small lobby, even related to a single issue, is a challenge. And we have to develop skills for that, understanding the processes of the parliament and assembly. But we will not only depend on that. And that's why farmers sitting on the Delhi borders and fighting everywhere are more impactful than the parliamentarians inside. But we are not apolitical. We have to understand the politics and the new changes and decisions that are coming up. For example, now the three states where the BJP lost its ground because of all the anti-people decisions, including the repeal of the workers' rights related 29 central acts and so on. We have got the vote bank developed based on our struggle with the people outside the parliaments. So this extra parliamentarian policies, the movements also really matter a lot. How we proceed with that is a question. But we have to really resort to, I think, the satyagraha, the various forms of satyagraha. What would have Gandhiji done if he was alive today? What would have Baba Sahib done as he did fight for the Dalits' right to the local water resource? So on and so forth. So we can really not go only into the history, but really look around and try and or take to the new forms of satyagraha. Now, Zameen Haq, Kabja Andolan, so on, where we not just assert rights academically, but we really sit there with the resources and have the satyagraha, where, of course, we have to be non-violent, but that non-violence really challenges not our bodies and minds, but our ability to fight the perseverant battle. And that's why I said the women really form the major force in such movements and such satyagrahas. But youth also matter. How do we really mobilize youths who have a different perspective? But now you see the Greta Thunberg had so much impact that, what is her name? Deepti Roy Rao from Bangalore. She had so much of impact. And there are the youth groups now, Fridays for Future and so on. We can, in our own locality, try our best to take the youths with us, even if starting with a nucleus group, to really reach out to the youths who are career-minded, who are for profit, who are for the maximum earnings and so on, and do not bother about it. I have seen in the pandemic situation, youth standing by the beds where their fathers or the brothers were lying or the mother was dying, and they really had a heartfelt feeling for oxygen. But where is oxygen coming from? And how did they come back, many of them, from their jobs where they were either thrown out or they had to leave the job and come and serve their fathers and mothers? So this kind of special situation, when it comes to be faced, I think the youth come forward. Even in Narmada struggle of last 36 years, which we are completing now soon, the youths and women both have really played a major role along with the elders. So I think our strategy for community mobilization and to find out those who from the community act like catalysts and really take the movement to the various levels, as I just mentioned, is a real challenge. It is also a challenge to reach out to the intellectuals. We have to search for the eminent persons. So it may be a former justice. It may be like Justice A.P. Shah or A.K. Patnaik or others. We may reach out to the academicians, we may reach out to artists and others, and use their force and eminence to really reflect upon the happenings at the ground level, and also about the struggle, and if the state becomes violent, to expose and challenge the state, those who are the vested interests. Now, this we have done through various ways and means. One is the fact finding. Now, you know, the struggle against the mining at one point of time really won the attraction and support from all over India. And that led the politicians to go down. I think meanwhile, in between, after that phase, the struggle was a little cowed down. And then there was no voice coming up because people thought now that is stopped forever. But that was not so. And hence, finally, the mining was started again. I don't know what is the situation today. But also, it was related to the Goa politics, where the minority and majority kept on changing, and the people crossing the boundaries of the parties in the standing in the market, the legislatures themselves to be sold themselves and being purchased and so on. It is very, very sad and valueless politics that needs to be challenged through the people's politics. So I think our struggles really resort to people's politics, where we bring in the various sections of population, as I said, intellectuals also, and Shramajivi, Buddhijivi kind of alliance really matters a lot. They may come in as fact-finding team, they may come in for the public hearing, they may come and sit at the Satyagraha for a short time. This mobilization of the supporters' strength and force is something that is done beautifully by some activists. I can refer to Kavita Srivastava from Rajasthan, who really mobilizes so many supporters. Even when Father Stan Sammy very sadly was pushed behind the bars, and today also my heart really bleeds for Father, for Sudha Bharadwaj, for everyone, Hani Babu and so on, Anand Teltumde, Gautam Navlakha. Many activists may lose heart. I'm thinking of some other move on this issue immediately. I'm waiting for the consent from others, my dear friends, but I will not disclose that today. I only feel that many legal battles, like petition was filed through me in the Supreme Court recently on giving them a parole or proper hospitalization and so on. So all these violent attacks and assault on the democratic struggles by the state is taking place through the fascist government and its fascist strategies and the UAPA kind of acts, no doubt about it. Yesterday only we remembered the emergency of 1975, and we said that this is undeclared emergency that we are facing, and we were facing house arrest yesterday itself at Gandhi Bhavan in Bhopal. But what I'm saying is that in such a situation, the civil society support really matters much more than some politicians' support and some state actors' support or the people's representative support. And that really needs to be our skill today to really take along. I think the farmers' movement also has achieved that to a great extent, but it also has to reach out through various other strategies to many and intellectuals who are in support but who have not arrived on the ground, because we are mass rooted movements and the struggles have to be people struggles, mass based struggles, not just grassroots activism. We need to really consciously plan our strategies to get the supporters, force as at the moments in various ways. Some may just write articles, some may be pro bono advocates, standing for us, like Prashant Bhushan ji or Sanjay Parikh ji and so on. But beyond that, if we have the public hearings where the eminent persons don't mind coming for public hearings or people's parliaments and so on, I think there the people get opportunity to speak out, and that real, the perspective and kind of acrosh coming from the real masses means a lot. We have to plan such strategic programs, and that programmatic strategy really works is what we feel, and that is a challenge for now. As far as legal actions are concerned, I will just refer to that and stop my dialogue. It is necessary that we understand the economics of today, that is really based on marketization and commodification, as I said in the beginning. And hence the corporate rule is really the state to shirk their responsibility and hand over their role, even not following the directive principles in the constitution and not granting the fundamental rights and ensuring those rights through the new laws, amendments, or the policies. We realize that all that needs to be challenged also through legal action. So, kanuni aur maidani ladai, ye hum hardam kehte hain, that combination of strategies is a must. Now, as far as legal action is concerned, we know the present state of judiciary. We can criticize it as much as we want. And also the NHRC, the National Human Rights Commission, that is now being led by Justice Arun Mishra. Everyone knows him very well. And also the NGT, National Green Tribunal. All these newly formed, comparatively newly formed, forai, are also really very, very important. Now, how to really take up the battles at NHRC or National Women's Commission or National Minorities Commission, National Green Tribunal is a very, very skilled matter. Whether it is the sand mining, whether it is atrocities against women under not just the posh laws, but the sexual harassment, but also the J.S. Verma committee's report. So various external aids, as I would refer to that, because in the legal terminology, when I fought all the cases since 2007 in the High Court and stood before the Supreme Court as petitioner in person, I realized that we cannot just depend only on the government official statistics and documents. Of course, the Right to Information Act has given us a great weapon to really bring out and expose the official data. That is also a skillful challenge that we pose, whether it is the data related to deaths during COVID pandemic or data related to the displaced population of any big dam and so on. We have to really dig that out, analyze it. We have to have a small cell of youngsters who are more on the social media, who use the IT technology and so on. Although I'm not for all this Googleization, but we are using that as a thorn to prick a thorn, as I always say. And we really are proving ourselves to be non-techno-savvy persons. And hence we depend on such younger youngsters team. But there are more and more youngsters only depending on the data which is gathered from the IT sources, nets. But we need different kind of networks on the ground also for data collection. And that is our challenge, to really build up the teams from within the communities where there are some youngsters. Like we have now many youngsters who have come out of our Jeevan Chalas. 6,000 and more students have passed out over the last 30 years in the Narmada Valley. And we can have at least 60 out of them, not more. But even they are a great resource. So we can really have this kind of a roadmap of the various actions from the bottom up, and then we can also reach out to each of these agencies with the external aids. And even in the High Court and Supreme Court, I have found that some fact-finding report, some alternative data collection really matters a lot. We have to fight the battle. We can plead ourselves. We need not need advocates in the Kala Dagla. We need a passionate presentation with full knowledge of the ground level situation. And I think that matters. Many of you need not pass law and the exams and get the degree, but really start pleading yourselves and prepare the local persons also to plead wherever they can and they can be permitted, and assert their right to plead also. So I think all of this really comes to our help. Now I would say that we have to also strike at the global financial institutions. Now, how is that done? Because many decisions related to projects and plans, whether it is the megacities plan, whether it is the central vista plan, where the resources are misused clearly, even in the situation where we are lacking in the medical services at the ground level, primary health centers and so on, there we have to really challenge such projects and plans which are extravaganza for gaining profit for the builders, developers, planners, but also politicians and bureaucrats. Now, how do we do that? We have to reach the global institutions many a times, and that can happen. Don't worry about how can we challenge a project where the World Bank is funding, or when the Bill Gates Foundation is now coming into the agriculture sector and Adanis and Ambanis are already building silos and godowns. So although the Supreme Court has stayed the three anti-farmer acts, they are going ahead. That is contempt of court. But farmers' movement is not dependent on court. So I will not say that they must go and we must go and fight that battle in the court itself. But we must really take a clear position about the global flow of capital as well. And that globalization, liberalization, booth, ghost that has captured the mindsets of many youths, many middle and upper class sections and so on. How can we really change that is a question. Now for that also we need the global statistics, global analysis, and also the struggles like the Occupation Wall Street, or when we stood before the United Nations offices in Geneva, or when we stood against the Enron company's offices, so on and so forth. We have to really fight the battle at that level also. I know that when the Narmada case was fought before the World Bank, it was necessary to approach many of the executive directors of G8, that was G8 then, now it is maybe G10, and really take some of them with us, and then challenge the World Bank president by standing before the World Bank office in Delhi, where we reached very softly and confidentially, secretly. And then the Wolfenson had to really give us a response when 3,000 people were sitting before the World Bank office. I think all these things we can really resort to challenge the international financial institutions. And another example is when Joe Attiali, my past colleague and present supporter, he stood in the court of law, Supreme Court of United States of America, through a group of Italian lawyers. They won the battle against the rule that if the project is funded by the World Bank, then the laws of the land are not applicable. Ridiculous. The sovereign nation state cannot assert its laws of the land, and the World Bank funding really rules out the rule of law itself at the country level. Now, the United States of America gave a good judgment, but the appeal is still being heard against it. So it is possible to work at all these levels, my dear friend, and it is necessary to do that. So ending it and concluding it, I will say that it is not just fighting against one project after another. what we need to really go ahead with is challenging the paradigm. Because without changing that, the saving environment is not going to happen. And that paradigm includes sectoral wrong choice of technology. Like in the water sector, it is the big dams. While USA's Tennessee Valley project, we followed that path. And today, USA has demolished, decommissioned more than 1,000 dams. So we are not really taking a decision on the policy or choice of technology as far as the state is concerned, based on the truly international understanding of what the world is facing and what it is going to face. The heat index is killing laborers because it is not just rising of temperature, but also humidity. The coming down of the glaciers and drying of the rivers and the sea ingress and sea rise and killing of species every year in thousands, all this is happening. And that climate change is not fully reflected in either the so-called statutory climate action plans or the understanding of people as to why is there the flood and drought-like cycles that are faced and why are the cyclones faced almost every year in this country. So it is necessary that we challenge the paradigm itself. And that challenge to the wrong technology of choice, technology in every sector, is a real challenge, because this cannot happen only through struggles. This needs the careful explanation, presentation, and propagation of alternative in every sector, whether it is decentralized water management, renewable sources of energy, saving natural forest at any cost, not destroying it as it is happening in Madhya Pradesh for the diamonds underneath, and so on. We need to really put this forth, and that's why the reconstructive work with these alternative technologies also really matters. Shankar Sharma ji from Karnataka, Anna Hazare from Maharashtra, Laurie Becker from Kerala, so many have shown the path to be followed, but we are really falling short of it. That is also because of the lifestyle. The limitations of struggle start with the limitations of activists. I think we, no one of us is Gandhi, but we not are not following Karyappa. We are really somewhere compromising in our own lives and lifestyles. When we can save the resources to the extent possible, use less water while bathing, don't keep the tap on, don't keep the lights on when you don't need that, etc., etc. So energy conservation, water conservation, all this, we have to push it forward. Even in the agriculture sector, when the movement is challenging the three laws and the corporatization, I am saying we kind of people are asserting there that we must also take up to organic farming. We must question the mechanization when the harvesters are coming from Punjab in Madhya Pradesh, our area, and killing the employment in the agriculture sector, so on and so forth. Now, these are the challenges within and also outside. We have to first exhibit demonstratively what is organic farming and how it is really successful. We just have done this and started it in the Narmada Valley. But we can do that with the alternative energy sources. Like the solar parabola we have in front of our office is just a symbolic gesture. But we have to really go beyond that in campaigns to be taken on the alternatives, alternative technologies. I think we are falling short of that. Especially those who are in struggles do not get time, energy for the alternative work on alternatives. But I think we must have both. And that combination of strategies really work the best. wherever and to whatever extent we could talk about alternatives and also devise policy statements on behalf of National Alliance of People's Movements as resolutions as this, we must take it further. We have to have fisheries policy, which is developed by the sectoral organizations and alliances. But we are not really yet taking up the holistic alternative economics and holistic alternative politics ahead that we can have not only through documentation, but a campaign, as I said. How to do this is a challenge before the environment protection movements. Friends, I must stop here. I've taken a long time. We are fighting the battle against the pollution to save the rivers. I have here the kind of, can you see it? I don't know my light here. This is the Bengal. Can you see it?
There's some problem with the video.
With the polluted land. With this kind of, I don't know, there is no light here, the polluted black soil that I can show you. And this black water is full of effluents, chemical, which has started now from Indore division and district to flow into Narmada. And yesterday's heavy monsoon might have taken it already to the banks of the river Narmada. And this is happening to every river where the industrialists are not wanting to spend on the ETPs and STPs for the urban sewage treatment plan or the effluent treatment plan. And they are really for profit at any cost. But that is the cost of our life and also livelihoods. I have not talked about livelihoods much. But you know that the natural resource-based livelihoods do not get the due respect and due the value, even monetary value. That is why the demand for the minimum support price, no, not minimum, we need optimum support price for the agricultural produce. Fighting this kind of battle in the present economy, which is really full of inequity, which I just explained, I think we must really take up these issues also, because although we want self-reliant agriculture, we don't want the agriculturists to depend only on the monetary value and market value, and they are our feeders. So we have to give them not just monetary value, but also respect and the due space, and their source of livelihood to live with dignity needs to be protected from the corporate entry and assault and so on. We still have to have these in-between battles, as I said. So going to the end of the struggle, which is our manzil, that needs to be put as an ideal. But in between, while struggling, if we keep on achieving some kind of equity, equitable measures, and benefits, and some kind of saving of the natural resources, whether rivers or air or forest or hills or sea and fisheries, we certainly can get the mass support in a better possible way. So to work out all these strategic struggle paths with non-violence at the crux of the value and also strategy, we really can move forward, and at various fora and forum, we can struggle and win the battle. Limitation is that we are not able to change the whole economy and turn it topsy-turvy. But we cannot lose hope, because otherwise people will lose hope in our social activism itself. So I think the people's movements and people's politics, not just the electoral politics, is the best path to be taken, for which we must not be in lockdown anymore. We must be offline in the field with the people, as we have experienced all these days. Thank you so much.
Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you very much, Medha ji. You can look at the chats. And there are some questions already.
Denzil, do put the questions because I cannot look at the chat so easily.
So one question is, nowadays mountains are depleted for construction, you know, I mean, all violations of law. That is one, because that is happening in Goa. The other thing is, another question came, Bolivia gained global attention for its law of the rights of Mother Earth, which accords nature the same rights as humans. But in India, we hardly think of any such concepts and steps. Unfortunately, laws and rules regarding nature conservation and preservation are merely words written on paper and hardly succeed when it comes to implementation. And even if some particular people raise their voice against such steps of depleting environment, they are put behind bars nowadays. So, you know, how we can resist the state and corporate power that is so dominant in the country. And the question is, what are the two or three weaknesses of the environment movement which we need to overcome? So to start with, we could have this. And then
I think the first question is really a statement of facts. The mountains are really coming down, not just the glaciers. You are right. And that's not only in Goa, but everywhere where the tourism is the main focus. In Uttarakhand as well, the Chardham Road, in the name of the religious pilgrims and pilgrimages, they are really leading to the, in a way, promoting landslides and all the calamities that have happened and are happening in this small state like Uttarakhand. The Deva Bhumi, as it is called, is because of such projects with the tunnels, big tunnels put into the hills. They are planning in the Narmada Valley also, and we are opposing. And also the Goa, where the tourism as the source of income for the state exchequer, and just as liquor is also a source of income. So they don't mind going to any extent. And we have to challenge this. There is no way out. We have to challenge the big development plans, not just individual projects, and challenge the prioritization, and challenge the impacts at the local level also. So I think all these various aspects, the social impacts, environmental impacts, irreversibility of damage, and not just demanding compensation, but saving that mountainous range and bringing out the real scientific assessment of the impacts, all this needs to happen. But we have to also mobilize the communities in the mountainous ranges. Now the Uttarakhand, where the population is not so thick as in the Narmada Valley, but there also the small groups really made a great impact when they stood up at the public hearing stages and challenged this thing or boycott the public hearings, and also challenged every project on the Alaknanda, Bhagirathi, Mandakini before the NGT, and succeeded with Sanjay Parikh, Ruthvik Datta kind of pro bono legal activists. So I think we have to use all these strategies if we have to save the mountains as well. And similarly, I think the mountainous communities really have a great relationship with natural resources, because they are away from the markets, they are away from the urbanization and industrialization based life. So I think they can be easily convinced, and they feel committed to save that, provided we reach out to the mountainous regions and be a part of the community. They will fight the battle. Our Adivasis in the Narmada fought the best of the battle. Even today, a few thousand of the families are yet to be rehabilitated. But 50,000 families who got rehabilitation in Narmada is also because of the Adivasis' main struggle, which was joined by the farmers and artisans and boatsmen and traders and fish workers from the plains as well. So we must really value the commitment and skill and kind of perseverance of the mountainous communities and mobilize them to the extent possible. Now, as far as the laws and rules and their violation are concerned, I did not speak about the Wildlife Act at all. I realized it. It's not just Go Raksha. It is the Jeeva Raksha that needs to be really conceived. I remember former Justice Jain Saab had come to Narmada Valley and we had a people's court sitting with the full decoration like a court and so on. And he said, always say Jal, Jangal, Zameen, Janwar. So that J, three J's need to be added with the fourth J. But Wildlife Act also takes into consideration the cultural tradition and so on. The environment includes archaeological treasure. Environment includes the cultural traditions and heritage of different kind, which lies today in the rural as well as urban areas as well. But that act is not fully followed. I agree that every law is violated, and hence we have to fight the legal and the social battles as well. As I said, kanuni and maidani ladai, ye dono karne ki zarurat hai. And I say that court ko hum log pura reject to nahi karenge. Judiciary is one of the pillars of democracy. We agree, we cannot say no totally to the going to courts. But it is necessary to understand that we should not go to the court till we have the people's power with us, till we have brought out the issues, analysis and solutions in front, whether it is the demand to scrap the project, to change the project, to implement the law and the process of due process of law, which is stated by every justice in every judgment. Do it with due process of law. But what is the due process of law? Which is consultation of the Gram Sabha? Do they do that? Never. So we have to really find out the spaces and really first, even the legal issues and arguments, we must do at the citizenry's level, outside the court first. And media matters. Today, the mainstream media is not giving, likely to give due space to the environment. But I have seen that after COVID pandemic or during it, because it continues in a way, we are not afraid of that. But when it continues, the media really is taking cognizance of the sources of oxygen, the real green ventilators, the rivers which are polluted, the viruses which are coming on to agricultural produce as well as onto our life itself. I think we must use whatever space from the mainstream, so-called mainstream media, which is Modi stream media actually, but we must use that space also, where Ambanis have the capital inputs and investments, and that really has its own impact and so on. Like the electoral politics also have their investment, and that's why the EVM machine to all manipulations, violence, communalization of politics, everything is taking place. Not going into that, but I'm saying that the various means of communication and the new means, alternative means of communication must be developed by us. That is also a challenge before the environmental movement. Thanks for reminding me of this gap that I was leaving. And that is our small newsletters to public actions. See, when you are on the streets, you really convey a lot. Your screaming really helps address the population that may be otherwise insensitive to the real impacts. How to do this? I think we can find out. The social media also matters, but it is a double-edged sword. Their IT cells are also more active than ours. We know that. But I think youngsters are using it. Now even the elders are with the WhatsApp in their hands all the time. But we need to not to lose sight of what's down, not just what's up. So
yeah.
We have to have our own apps, which are not only on this small machine, but which are the alternative media strategies, which we have to go back to the movements of those days when the mobiles were not in our hand, but the activists, political activists, social activists were mobile themselves. We must be mobile ourselves. We must reach out to wherever struggle is taking place. Need not praise activists like me for that. I think we all must and all can do this very, very, very easily, provided we have courage. Now, this question about putting behind bars those who are challenging the state on destruction of environment or wrong non-sustainable policies, I think that is the challenge. Our friends who are behind the bars are fighting for our freedom. Father Stanley is fighting for our freedom. We cannot forget that. We cannot forget him. And that's why I feel we must take to the indefinite action on that issue as well. Tell me who of you are ready to be with me in that action. I will not speak about it here, but I think it's high time. We cannot just say, oh, they are facing hell, they are in bad health and so on. It's very, very sad that 120 or 135 crores population cannot challenge the acts like UAPA Act and the NIA-like agencies, and they're all anti-democratic and fascist decisions and actions. We must find ways out of that, for which we need to be courageous. We must speak out. We may go behind the bars and we are all in the queue maybe, but we cannot leave that, and we must proceed ahead. And if more and more are courageous, then the courts also get some confidence to say that, look, the state is not discriminating between the people's protest in the constitutional framework and terrorism. This is what Delhi High Court said in its recent judgment. But it also underlined the sentence further that this judgment cannot be used as basis
precedent
for others release or others being bailed out. Now,
okay.
Court has its own limitation. So we will also have our limitation, but I think we have the courage and commitment which we can take forward.
Yeah, okay. There are actually a lot of questions, but I think we are all run out of time. So now I
request... There are one or two other questions, different kind. Please take it. I can fill the gap.
Yeah.
But if time is over,
yes,
let's talk.
Time is up. I mean, there are a lot of talking about nationalization of the rivers, and we also have the coastal zone. Hearings, public hearings, people are not, the government is not listening to that. So all these, and also with regard to participation of students and so on. So there were some questions on that as well.
Students.
Yeah. So, but I think.
I will just say a few words about these 3 points. That yes, rivers are also treated like commodities now. While those are the arteries, 80 kilometers sea has ingressed. You know how the Madai River is fought for by the Goans. And interstate conflicts really matter a lot in saving every river. That's why we have to have people-to-people dialogue. Whether it is Mulla Periyar or whether it is Madai River. I think unless we have dialogue people-to-people, I suggested it that Maharashtra, Goa and Karnataka people must have a dialogue on the Krishna, on Madai. Kerala and Tamil Nadu must have a dialogue on the Mulla Periyar. We have not succeeded much because even the politicians support sometimes when they are in the opposition, and they take a different position once they are in power. These kinds of experiences really teach us a lot. And that's why I think the popular strategies, popular in the wider sense of the term, people-based strategies is something that will change the politics and economics at large, and also the movement politics, our strategies also can be changed if we really take that path. Now, the students' actions are a must. When I say youth, I don't only refer to students, but there is no doubt that the students' movements have contributed a lot. And that's why, in the name of Delhi riots and violence, student activists from Jamia Millia to JNU were put on behind the bars. When anyone challenges the system with basic questions, the state cannot tolerate. The state is a coward agency, and it is not even sovereign. It is under the pressures and effect and the influences by the capital and the capitalist. So it is necessary to understand that they are afraid of all of us, and that's why they put the lions and lionesses behind the bars, not the cats and dogs. So it is necessary to become a part of that force. When Father Stan Sammy had questioned the Pathargadi, it was the assertion of the Adivasis' rights through Gram Sabhas and the sovereign village republics, as Mahatma Gandhiji also had referred to, but it was not fully reflected in our constitution, got into it in 1992, 73rd and 74th amendment. But when Father really operationalized it on the ground with his colleagues and comrades, he became a terror for the fascist state. And that's why he is behind bars. Now, to take up that battle, I'm sorry and I feel ashamed and pained, because Father really called more than once and invited to Pathargadi to support the movement. But I myself could not reach. NAPM colleagues did reach there, and somehow the dates did not match. But it is today, at least, you all, my Jesuit friends, please reach out to that region. Don't leave that as an orphanage when Father is out. Take it up. That will really give further confidence and challenge to us and challenge to the state. I think that is how we should respond to these kinds of state violence, which is denying freedom, freedom of expression, freedom of protest, which is granted to us by Constitution and Human Rights Charter as well. It is necessary, therefore, that we really follow the same path. It is like jail bharo. We need not immediately take thousands to behind the bars, but we must show that we are not afraid of the actions that they have taken. And when others and our brothers and sisters are there inside, they are really the freedom fighters today. So just like the freedom movement, just like the movements of farmers since Birsa Mundas and Swami Sahajananda Saraswati's, since the Nav Nirman movement in Gujarat and Bihar, and then all over the country by Jai Prakash Narayan. There are so many examples where the people really showed this courage, and that only made the state go down and change the fascist rule towards more or less democratic rule. Now, changing one party by another is not the ultimate solution. You and me know that. But awakening people from the lifestyle related issues to the development paradigm issues is something that is a great challenge. And it really takes hard work, very hard work. But I think we should not leave out any issue. We must have that kind of alliance. Wherever we invite you and you invite us, we must try our best to reach out. We cannot do it every time. I really feel that we fall so much short that any praise of our work is really making us feel more responsible and more humble. So I think I will end this with good questions that are appreciable. And let us continue this dialogue, beyond dialogue into action.
Okay, thanks. Thank you very much, Medhaji. Now, I think Simon Fernandez.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, so I invite Simon Fernandez to, you know, give the vote of thanks.
Dear friends, I feel privileged and honored to share this online platform along with a great activist, social and environmental activist, Ms. Medha Patkarji. It is a pleasure to listen to her. Because of time constraints, we have to close the program here. But on behalf of all of you, I would like to express gratitude towards her for taking time off from a busy schedule. I would also like to thank Father Denzil Fernandez, the Executive Director of Indian Social Institute Delhi, for moderating this session and also playing a role to get Medha Patkar on board today so that we could listen to her. It was enriching, enlightening, and informative, and also more challenging to us. He has posed some challenges before us, especially giving us a roadmap. The challenge before us is we need to work at different levels. We need to understand the power of the people's movements, and the choices that we are making, especially when it comes to the developmental paradigm. I think that is the greatest challenge, that we are choosing a wrong developmental paradigm, that is choice of technology and the lifestyle, where we are compromising on, especially on judicious use of natural resources like jal, jungle and jameen. And finally, the greatest challenge is to have an holistic alternative economics and holistic alternative politics. Thank you, Medha Patkarji, for all this information, for challenging us. And as you said that we need to join you. Yes, we need to join hands, build alliances. You are a great example and inspiration before us. Let us motivate ourselves and tell Medha that, Medha Patkarji, aap aage badho, hum tumhare saath hai. Let's fight this battle together. Thank you very much. I would also like to thank...
dear Simon and Denzil. I am thankful to Denzil and his team. Also because I must mention that Indian Social Institute played a great role by coming as a fact-finding research team, which Denzil was a part of. And they really brought out The Submergence of Justice, a book which you all can go through, how much diligent data gathering and analysis they carried out, through great hard work, reaching out to each village community in much of the submergence affected region in the Narmada Valley. So the external aids I was referring to, one of which was this book and the research which we used in the courts as well. So this kind of inputs by you all from time to time who have supported our struggles at various in various states. I have not referred to many struggles in Goa, but also the struggle to save that village community from the IIT's plan to encroach upon the Adivasi community and their land, which was victorious at the end. I think those have taken place in Goa as well. So I think your inputs in all these struggles are also very appreciable. And I thank you for those, not only for organizing this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Medha ji, for those encouraging words. Definitely the alternative data collection you spoke about, we need to challenge the official data, and that requires study and research and collecting of proper data. I would like to thank the organizers, especially the friends of Jesuit Goa province, Jesuits, not only the Goa province Jesuit, but the friends, especially Frederick Norana, who is instrumental, he is on board helping us to organize this event. There are other events which are lined up. My dear friends, those who have come and become part of this event, I thank you all for joining us, participating, asking questions, and being with us, supporting and collaborating with us. Thank you very much, one and all. God bless you. Jindabad.
Thank you. All the best, Medha ji, for all your struggles, farmer struggles, that Korigaon, no? That other struggle there. So, all the best. All the best for all your struggles. We are with you.
Thank you, Denzel.
Thank you. Bye.